Now that we have discussed predicting the enthalpy of reactions or physical changes, we're going to move into our calculation of enthalpy. Again, if you remember from first semester chemistry, you used three different setups to calculate the enthalpy of reaction. For this semester, we only use one calculation, and we'll build up to defining that equation. For our calculation, we use a quantity called the heat of formation of a substance. This value is calculated when we form 1 mole of a substance from its elements. So the two key components of measuring the heat of formation is that we make 1 mole of a substance and that we form it from the elements. For heat of formation, we are specifically describing standard state conditions, and we'll be referring to these throughout the chapter. When we describe standard state, if we're working with gases, they're at 1 atmosphere pressure. Reactions are run at 25 degrees Celsius for standard conditions, and if we have solutions, those are 1 molar concentration. To illustrate the idea of heat of formation, I want to write the equation for the formation of water. And so again, the two key components here are that we are making 1 mole of a compound, and we form it from elements in their standard states. So water is made from both hydrogen, which is diatomic, and oxygen, also diatomic gases. So these are the elements that form water. And then the second part of this is balancing the equation so that we only form 1 mole of our product. This is the one time when we balance using fractions if we need to. So realize, of course, the hydrogen is already balanced, but in order to balance the oxygen, it means I need a half for the coefficient there. So this equation is the heat of formation of water, or describes the reaction for it. So in other words, if I were to carry this reaction out in a calorimeter, I could measure how much heat is exchanged to make water. What we have to recognize when we're describing our enthalpy of formation values is for elements in their standard states, enthalpy of formation values, the subscript of F specifically describes formation, elements are always going to have values of zero. And that should make sense because it doesn't require any heat to make an element. That's how it naturally occurs. So there is no heat exchange to make hydrogen and oxygen because that's how they naturally exist. What it means is if I carried this reaction out in a calorimeter, I would calculate a total heat given off at a value of -285.83 units of kilojoules per mole. So again, it's energy, so joules. It's a large value, so we use kilojoules. And then because I measured 1 mole of the substance, I have per mole in my unit here. Now, it should make sense to you that this is a negative quantity. Think about what type of reaction we've carried out here. When I wrote this equation, realize that I've essentially written a combination reaction. Because I'm forming bonds to make water, I get a negative value. Combination reactions tend to be negative. So when you look up enthalpy of formation values, two key things. One is, again, for elements, they will be zero. And for most substances, they will have a negative enthalpy of formation value because they are combination reactions. I say most, there are exceptions to this. Some values will be positive, but you can predict a negative value for most of these. To calculate our enthalpies of reaction, we will use values in Appendix G. Sorry for the highlighter there, meant to take that off. Values in Appendix G can be looked up. You will actually be looking up enthalpy of formation values in that appendix if they're not given. And as we go through the chapter, we'll keep referring to values in Appendix G for reference. So that was defining enthalpy of formation values. And the key thing to recognize is that we will use those values in order to calculate the enthalpy of reaction. The equation we use this semester is written here. This one is not on your equation sheet. So your blue periodic table version that you have, it is not on there. Luckily, it's one you've seen before, and we use it three different ways in this chapter. So you will be familiar with it by the end of the chapter. In this reaction, our setup is that we are calculating the sum of the product of moles. So remember, N represents how many moles. For our moles, we're just using coefficients from our balanced equation. So for any given substance, we'll multiply its coefficient by its enthalpy of formation value. We add up all of the values of our products, and then we subtract from that all of the values of our reactants. So again, remember, anytime we're calculating a change, change is always final minus initial. For a given chemical reaction, final would be the products, and initial would be the reactants. And so an easy way to remember it is we're just doing products minus reactants for these. So again, enthalpy of formation values, if they're not given, you want to look them up in Appendix G. And a reminder again that enthalpy of formation values are zero for elements. One last note before we get into an example is to make sure you watch physical states when you're looking up values. There is a difference in the value of water, for example, in its liquid state versus its gas state. This should make sense. We already predicted that there is an energy change as a substance goes through a physical change. And so as it goes from liquid to gas, there would be a change in that energy value. So just make sure if you're looking up values, you compare or watch for using liquid versus gas versus solid. All right, so the example we're going to use to calculate the enthalpy of reaction. We want to calculate enthalpy of reaction for this following equation. Couple of things that I want you to do before we get started. One is to notice that this is not balanced. Because we're using coefficients in our equation, we need to make sure all equations are balanced. The second thing is that I would like you to predict the sign of enthalpy for this one. Look at the type of reaction, and based on the predictions we went through in our last video, identify whether you predict it to be a positive or negative. So go ahead and pause the video, balance the equation, and predict the sign of enthalpy. When we return, we'll get into the calculation. All right, welcome back. For this video, what you should see, or for this example, what you should have gotten for your coefficients is a 1 for the C2H4, 3 for oxygen, and 2 for both of our products. So that's our balance. Predicting sign. Hopefully you recognize that this is a combustion reaction. And remember, when we think of combustion, we think of fire or explosions. That should give off a lot of heat, so we predict a negative sign for it. In order to calculate, here I've given the values of enthalpy of formation, so we'll go through the setup to calculate this. One key thing to recognize here is that I've given the value of 0 for oxygen, but I could just as easily omit it. You should recognize that because it's in its elemental form, that is going to have a value of 0. So I don't have to give that value. So if you ever notice that one is missing, look and see if it is in fact an element. For the setup for this one, I like to do my setup in brackets. So again, we're going to do products minus reactants. My first substance is going to be carbon dioxide. So I have 2 moles of carbon dioxide multiplied by its value, -393.5 kilojoules per mole. And I'm going to add to that my other product, just 2 moles of gaseous water. So again, if I were to look these up, I want to make sure I'm paying attention to the physical states. That has a value of -241.8 kilojoules per mole. So I've put my products in brackets, and that's just to help differentiate from my reactants so that it's easier to keep track of signs. For our reactants, we have 1 mole of C2H4 times its value of a 52.5. Notice this is one of the exceptions to the prediction. Again, we said that most enthalpy of formations would be negative. This one happens to be positive. And then I don't need to include it, but I'm just reminding myself I've accounted for it, my zero value for oxygen. For these calculations, the other recommendation is that I like to do all of my math for the products first. So multiplying my values for carbon dioxide and steam and adding those together. And for my products, I get a negative 1270.6. For my reactants, I get just a 52.5. And I like doing it this way because of the signs. It helps eliminate any sign errors in trying to enter everything at once. So our final answer for this one is a negative, which we predicted, so that's awesome. 1,323.1. Last discussion with this calculation is Sig Figs. They're not going away, kids. All right, so here, recognize that our math was primarily addition and subtraction. Right? We were adding the substances together and then subtracting products and reactants. Because we're focusing mostly on addition and subtraction, we're going to report answers to least decimal places. When we look back at our given values up here, we realize that everything went to one decimal place. So our answer will also go to one decimal place. The other discussion is units. So recognize in our setup that our moles cancel out for each one. As you go through and do your setups for these, I don't expect you to write out these full units. I do expect you to remember that your moles cancel out in this calculation. And so your final answer would be negative 1,323.1 kilojoules.